Thank you. Hi.
Hi.
I'm going to read an old fiction piece, a short story. I'm going to read the beginning and the end of it. It's called Darling, Darling, and it's told in the voice of a young man. Oh, and you can tell that it's old because of the mention of PlayStation 3. Darling, darling. I met a girl named Megan one summer's day when I was at the deli. She was buying blueberries, and I told her that was a good idea. I mentioned the study done a few years ago that discovered blueberries make you smart. She laughed and gave me her number. Megan had thick mud brown hair and sparkly black eyes like a deer, but she was short and big around the hips and legs. Anyway, I kept the number. When I came home, Matt was awake, sitting on the floor playing PS3. I greeted him while I tacked Megan's number to the corkboard. "Who is it this time?" Matt asked me. "No one," I said. "I probably won't call her." I looked at the other numbers and email addresses on the board, all in the same type of handwriting, with the short tails to the G's and Y's, the fast, narrow loops in the A's and O's and at signs, the French sevens crossed in the middle. Caitlin, Paige, Jen, Megan. The only different one was Ida, whose name and number were in a scratchy, masculine hand because I wrote them down myself. She was the one I least wanted to call, though I didn't really want to call any of them. Matt snorted at me. "Dude, darling," he said. "They get on you like barnacles. It's ridiculous." "I don't know about that," I said to him. "I mean, none of the really hot ones do." "Fuck you, the really hot ones." He paused his game to give me the finger, then resumed play. But I knew I was right. I left the room to take a nap, and because I didn't want to argue about it. I met Ida in a dark bar called Schoolhouse one weeknight when it was already around 12. I approached her while she was buying a drink because of her graceful hands and net stockings, and because from the back you can't tell if they're going to be crazy. I leaned over and just stood beside her a while, my arm almost touching hers, to see if she'd notice. Finally, she locked eyes with me and said, "How old are you? Like 22? I told her I am 22. She looked at me like she was going to fling her arms around my neck in almost a big sisterly way. But she didn't yet. I let her touch my hand, and I smiled at her. "It's my birthday," she told me with a faint pout. I asked how old she was, but she wouldn't tell me. I still don't know. I could tell she was hammered, but I forgave her since it was her birthday. The bartender handed her a martini, and she about fell over herself thanking him, looking radiantly happy. Then, "You are fucking tall," she said to me. I get that a lot. "Let me guess how tall you are. 6'5"? And I told her she was exactly right. She hit the nail on the head. She should make a career of it at Six Flags Great Adventure. It did feel good to make her laugh. She picked up my hand and pulled me to a booth at the back of the room where her friends were. They were mostly guys, men, and that made me uneasy. "Brian, darling, is from Salton, Ohio," she crowed to them. "He is my birthday present to myself." I smiled and nodded, raised my pint glass an inch in salute. They seemed cool enough, if drunk and dirty. But before I knew it, Ida was crying. God, I hadn't signed on for a crying girl. Her friends left us alone at the bar, a jerk thing to do to someone on her birthday. Did they mean to consign her to my protection? I certainly didn't know how to protect her. And then she told me a story from her childhood, and that story made her cry. Oh, was it boring. The divorced parents hadn't seen each other in years, the mother 9 months pregnant with the stepfather's child, a fight over money, yelling and the F word, the huge pregnant mother throwing a punch at the father, leaving him with a bruised lip, then dragging Ida downstairs where they got into the stepfather's car. So what? I wanted to tell her that my mom is dead, that my mom was killed in a car crash and I never even got to see her body. Not that I wanted to at that point, but anyway, to suck it up, Ida, for Christ's sake. Instead, I just sighed and looked at her hands on the tabletop, amazed that she could be so sad about something so small. But she needed a hug. Her face and slack shoulders screamed for it. And so, of course, Brian the sap hugged her. What a waste of my compassionate energies. We kissed there, made out. There in the booth, I cuddled Ida in my unready arms. I don't want you to forget me, Brian, darling, she slurred, her face slashed with a big, messy smile, because just like that, she was happy again. I told her I definitely wouldn't, which was the truth. I try not to lie to anyone. She took a black marker out of her purse, then rolled up my sleeve and wrote her phone number on my arm. Was that sexy? I'm sure she meant it to be. She blew on my arm to dry the numbers, then rolled my sleeve back down. And then, or very soon after that, she threw her coat on and ran out of the schoolhouse. I mean, she ran. Even in net stockings and high-heeled boots, she was fast. The number took forever to wash off. Matt happened to see it a couple days later, and he said, "Darling, dude, that's insane." I couldn't take a nap. My body wasn't as tired as the rest of me. I thought, why do I place myself in these situations? Why don't I just stay home and write an eHarmony personal ad featuring a photo of myself with a basketball in one hand and a puppy in the other, rather than scam rooms for women who look good in the dark after three beers? I wondered how old Ida was, which birthday she had been celebrating that night. Could she have been more than 30? I told myself that if I ever went out with her, I'd find out. And if she was over 30, I wouldn't call her again. That sounded silly, though, considering I didn't want to call her in the first place. Maybe I would call her again only if she was over 30, just to see what being with a 30-something was like. I mean, it had been fun kissing her. I liked how she had taken my face in her hands and searched it with her eyes. Still, her craziness. I resolved to let a few days go by and then go out with Megan. My dad was expecting a phone call, so I called him. He deals okay with being a widower, but I feel he appreciates me keeping tabs on him, especially in the summer. Mom died in the summer. "What's the business, Bob?" I could picture him dabbing his shiny bald head just in from mowing the square of dandelions the darlings have always called a front lawn. "Bride guy, I'm infinitely more interested in your business," he said, chuckling. "You bringing any ladies home to meet me? You can bring two, you know. I'll take the ugly one off your hands." Why can't anyone I know ever shut up about my love life? "I'm still flying solo," I told him. "But give it some time. I'll bring you Miss G.W. Bridge, and you'll make her the best ribeye steak she's ever eaten. That should be a thrill for you." "Well, it sounds like paradise." He kept laughing and laughing. I know I should call him more often. He loves it. We talked about 4th of July weekend, which was coming up. I had bought the bus ticket home already. I was not looking forward to spending 9 hours on a bus, of course, but I didn't tell him that. It would have been too expensive for me to rent a car, and for him too, if he decided to be my hero. So we just talked about grilling and watching TV. Yes, we talked about watching TV, not even about any of the shows. Is it any wonder I can't attract spectacular girls when this has been the tenor of my upbringing? Right, I'm going to skip forward, but I'll tell you that what happens is that Brian encounters Ida again and decides he likes her and invites her to come back to Ohio with him for 4th of July. And 4th of July is the anniversary of his mom's car accident and death. And it turns out that the dad fancies her. The fairgrounds were predictably annoying. Hot sausage, funnel cake, dunk the chump. Sauerkraut and taco sauce all over the grass. A Ferris wheel that was itself on wheels. Natives of Salton and environs with sunburnt peeling noses hitting me on the back going, "Check out, darling, darling, he's all grown up." Ida hooked her arm through mine, putting on a scowl to prevent them from saying anything further. My dad was having a blast chatting with the two of us. He wanted to know everything about Ida, and she threw back her head and told him, the nice parts at least. I strained to listen, straggling behind them with a piece of pork loin on a stick. He wore his fancy khakis with a braided belt, black sneakers, a black t-shirt with a trout on it. "So how do you support yourself, honey?" She had been a nanny, a vet tech, a limo driver, a waitress. She was a waitress now. She said she liked living in New York. Looking up at my dad with a steely smile, she said, "In my neighborhood, everyone knows me. They all have something to say to me when I walk down the street." Under the floodlights, I saw tiny cracks in her layer of makeup. I wondered if she could be as old as 40. We found an out-of-the-way picnic table to sit at for the fireworks, tolerably far from the crowds at the expense of a good view. Dad inhaled the plastic cups of beer at a furious rate, then stacked the empty cups on the table next to where Ida was sitting. She had her feet on the bench and every so often stood up to see the fireworks better, raising her fist in triumph, even though they were short, dim fireworks. She yelled at the sky. Is that all you got? I want more explosions! Explode! Every time my dad put his cup down, he slid his eyes up the back of her legs. When the pyrotechnical display was over, we stuck around, waiting for the mob to dissipate before heading back to the car. Dad was wasted. He slumped over to get a better look at Ida and said, "You're so great. You've made Bob Darling's weekend, honey." He seemed incapable of calling her by her name. "Tell me something about yourself." She straightened her back. "One time, I was staying in my dad's hotel room when my mom punched my dad in the mouth," she told him. "I guess that's something." She was paddling her feet, flipper-like, off the end of the picnic table. I got up to get myself another beer because I had already heard this one. I know I shouldn't have gone anywhere. Ida's shoulders were shaking when I got back, and Dad was standing in front of her, swaying with his arms around her. He was stroking her hair. When he leaned his face into hers, she wrenched her body away. "Jesus, get off her!" I never knew my voice could get that loud. "Get the hell off her! Dad!" I threw the full cup of beer away over my shoulder, ran to them through the dirt. "Come on, sweetie," he drawled. "No reason for those blue eyes to be crying." She was standing up now, her face flashing fear, tears glistening on her cheeks. His grip was tight, tight enough to bruise around both her wrists. Before I could get there, she wriggled free of him on one side, grabbed his middle finger, and bent it all the way back on his hand. He roared in pain, crumpled over, and brought the hand between his knees. Having arrived too late to do anything, I stood motionless between them. I had tunnel vision and my chest hurt. When Ida stepped toward me, trying to take my arm, I shoved her. They put a splint on Dad's finger at the first aid station. It was a sprain. When he staggered out, I put my hand on his back and we shuffled to our car, the one we called the new car, even though it is 8 years old now. With a look on her face that told me nothing, Ida offered to drive us home. "Easy does it," she told my dad as he was getting in on the passenger side. "Everybody in?" Dad shifted the seat back so he'd have more leg room. "Watch it, Bob," I said out of habit when the back of his seat slammed against my knees. "Can't be helped, Brian," he apologized. "We're a tall family." In the windshield, reflected against the black road, I saw the ghost of Ida's tired face, her lush round mouth cut at the edges with frown lines. Next to it, and smaller, I saw my own face, slack-jawed, hollow-cheeked, ashen. "Hey there, handsome." The white traffic lines sliced between us. My dad passed out in his seat and snored. "I'm okay, baby," Ida said to me later, whispering, after I'd seen him to bed and she was in my room. "It's okay, Brian. You didn't hurt me." She was trying not to cry at first, but I let her and kissed her face when the tears ran down it. Her kisses were greedy. Her whole body was greedy, her skin hot and soft in the dark. I let her cry. I cried, so it was only fair. This was the only time she and I have ever been together. Dad actually walked with us to the bus station and saw us off, trying to be breezy. "Safe home, you guys," he said, clumsily waving the giant splint. "Safe home?" He looked away from me when I shook his good hand. Ida patted him on the arm once and turned right around to climb the steps into the bus. We saw him staring at us from the window as we pulled away, his face dark and still. We slept for the first leg of the trip, the flat fields transforming into mountains again around us, and it was 2 hours or more before we spoke. "I want to ask you something," she said. "And you don't have to answer me if you don't want to, but it was just something I was wondering about." I told her I was all ears. "Who was the last person you were in love with?" Her question hurt my chest and belly, my whole torso. I didn't want to tell her, but I did. I described the girl I went out with in college who wanted to marry me and who I had to throw back to the wrestling frat wolves. I hadn't wanted to marry her. "Thanks," she said. "Don't worry, I won't tell anyone." She picked up my hand and I let her hold it. "So what about you?" I asked her. "You don't go in for that love business, do you?" Her eyes glittered when she laughed up at me. "You don't know me very well at all." Then she told me the story of the guy she used to live with, an actor from Toronto. He broke up with her because he decided he wanted to have a baby, even though they'd known for a long time that Ida can't get pregnant. She is infertile. It was a messy breakup for her in a tough year. Most of the way home, she curled up away from me, her cheek pressed against the window. Once or twice, I put my head on her shoulder, and she let me, but it was uncomfortable, so I didn't do it for long. I see Ida all the time, but I've still never called her. We just run into each other, in the bars and on the street. Sometimes I go to the restaurant where she works, and she lets me have a bucket-sized sweet vodka drink for free. She's always so happy to see me that I wonder if she's going to bite my head off. A week or so after 4th of July, I went on a date with Megan. She showed up at my door in black shorts that were too short for her big legs, but I let her in anyway, and we had a beer before going to the movies. When Matt saw her, I thought he was going to burst out singing. He tipped his baseball hat to her and kissed her hand. Megan giggled and adored the attention, and our date was uneventful. So afterward, I told Matt I didn't mind if he wanted to call her. "You have made me the happiest man in the fucking galaxy," he said. It's a pretty ordinary thing when you think about it, love. I left Matt and went to grab a cheeseburger at Dugan's. "Aw, how are you, darling?" Mike, the manager, shouted with outstretched arms as I walked in. I got him to give me a pint, then ordered the cheeseburger and waited for it with my head in my hands. The burger arrived. I applied ketchup to it. Two girls passed in front of me in a frenzied discussion. "God, I'm so fat," one said to the other. "I need the gym like nobody's business." The second one smiled and eyed me. I suspended my burger in midair for a second to smile back at her, my mouth wide open. At the table next to mine, another girl was smearing moisturizing lotion on her throat, her thin blonde hair all broken off into split ends. Chewing the burger, I raised my eyebrows at her. She tilted her head and blew the hair from her eyes, her back and shoulders hunched in what looked like defeat. I swallowed and took another bite while all around me, women got older.